Everything Bad is Good for You is a new series of short audiobooks dedicated to the much maligned traits that we should actually be promoting. Just as Susan Cain's Quiet showed that introversion is actually a superpower, and Sarah Knight made us all realise that not giving a fuck can actually improve our lives, these surprising and entertaining audiobooks will celebrate our perceived flaws and show why embracing, rather than suppressing them, can be the difference between failure and success. Why ignoring your children will make everyone happier. Or what to neglect when you're neglecting. Written and read by Tom Hodgkinson. Chapter 1. What to neglect when you're neglecting. Many years ago, when my children were small, I sat on a sunny bank on the wilds of Exmoor and opened a dusty old copy of a book called Phoenix, The Collected Papers of D.H. Lawrence. In this weighty tome, published after his death, I found an essay called Education of the People. At the time, I was completely exhausted by childcare and confused by parenting manuals. Having children seemed like a lot of hard work for which you got no gratitude, and worse, they would probably grow up to hate you. Socrates' wife, Xanthippe, had this problem. After caring for her son, Lamprocles, changing his nappies, educating him, he turned against her when he was a teenager, because she was liable to lose it and scream at him. No one could put up with her vile temper, Lamprocles told his philosophical dad, when Socrates was imploring him to be a bit more appreciative of his poor mum. After all, said father to son, she fed him when he was a baby and raised him into a young man, all at no benefit to herself. Which do you think is the harder to bear? Asked Socrates rhetorically. A wild beast's brutality? Or a mother's? I should say a mother's when she's like mine, answers the surly ingrate. But Lawrence's long essay, written in 1919, helped me enormously. It contains the following piece of rather startling and counterintuitive parenting advice, which could be summarised as, don't even bother. How to begin to educate a child. First rule, leave him alone. Second rule, leave him alone. Third rule, leave him alone. That is the whole beginning. These simple words appeared to contradict every piece of advice I had picked up on the subject. If there was one thing you were not to do as a parent, it was to leave them alone. On the contrary, you are expected to be terribly busy at all times, involving the children in edifying after-school activities, while telling them all the while how amazing and special they are. This, on top of feeding them organic quinoa berries, finding them suitably sophisticated playmates and an infinitely enormous pile of laundry, while also trying to earn some money. And the advice you get. Everyone bothers you with their crappy tips. The experts, of course, start bothering you well before the child is born. Earnest parenting manuals, often written by puritanical Americans, include titles like the famous What to Expect When You're Expecting, with their passive-aggressive snippets such as, it's fine if you have been drinking alcohol up to now, but now would be a great time to stop. Been taking cocaine? No problem. But maybe stop now, you evil, selfish mother. Later, shelf loads of advisors pitch in with their thoughts and all insist on a high level of parental input. You must play with the child. You must limit its screen time. You must help it to be creative. You must hold it tightly. You must tell it how great it is. Put simply, you must be the perfect parent. Naturally, this drive towards perfectionism causes rows between the two extremely knackered and inevitably imperfect parents. The mothers are torn between being career women and domestic paragons. The fathers are drawn in to help by the mothers and are no better at striking the right balance. Both, mystifyingly, seek solace from the overlords of Silicon Valley, and go on to add sales scams like Facebook and Google for help and support in the midst of their isolation. The grandparents, of course, are nowhere to be seen. They're playing tennis, going on cruises, or dating. The poor young parents are stranded and alone. To make matters worse, other rival parents, in an astonishingly impolite move, post happy pictures of themselves on Instagram which show them cuddling their babies and enjoying every moment of parenthood. Before you had babies, you were a couple of loafers about town, enjoying sensual pleasures and everyday freedom and lying in bed all weekend. Now you are engaged in a horribly competitive parenting war, fighting a battle to produce the best children, and, naturally, you feel that yours falls short of the platonic ideal. Other parents torment you by posting photographs of their amazing holidays and their beautiful children on their social show-off pages. Just remember, by the way, this basic truth. The camera always lies. It is a tiny millisecond of reality, and even the most furious, resentful parent can smile for a second. But even though we all know that social media is a lie, we still fall for it. But there is, of course, no ideal. Childhood should be messy and chaotic and fun. Lawrence warms to his theme and produces the shocking notion that children should, quote, be given to stupid, fat, old women who can't be bothered with them. Leave the children alone. Pitch them out into the streets or the playgrounds and take no notice of them, he writes. And in fact, this is not so far away from what my parents did to my brother and me. There was plenty of love around, but not a huge amount of active parenting. My baby boomer parents were more interested in their own careers and having fun. One of my abiding memories of childhood is coming downstairs on a Sunday morning with my brother to see wine-stained tablecloths, overflowing ashtrays, and guests asleep under the table, snoring. Another memory was sitting in the car outside a pub with a packet of crisps and a fizzy drink, while my parents drank and smoked inside the pub. I don't think even that the verb parenting existed then. This is not to say that parenting advice is something new. On the contrary, it is ancient. There is a long and noble tradition stretching back to Rousseau, to John Locke, and, as we've seen, Socrates in the 4th century BC, who, by the way, insisted that Xanthippe's hard words to her son are actually character-forming, since they help the young man to develop the armour needed to deal with difficult people. So you could argue that bad mothers are actually good mothers, and that excessive mollycoddling will lead to weakness. Perfection in the parent will lead to a feeling of inadequacy in the child. So my message is, be useless.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.